What's going on, everybody? This is Clint from the Die Hard MMA podcast, and it is Total Takedown Thursday, brought to you by PubSportsRadio.com. I got a little bit of a change of scenery here for you this week, but don't you worry, we'll be right back to the man cave here in a day or two. Let's talk about UFC Vegas 26. We're going to talk about how long these fights are going to last. Are we going over? Are we going under? 1.5 rounds? 2.5 rounds? Will or won't the judges be involved? That's what we're talking about today. Make sure you smash that like button, subscribe here to PubSportsRadio.com. We're back on the main channel, baby. We've been streaming on the alternate channel because of a little YouTube snafu, so if you have not subscribed to the main channel here on Pub Sports Radio, that's where all the content is going to be moving forward, so hit that sub button here on this side of things as well. Let's dive straight on into this thing. Kicking off the night, we've got Christian Aguilera taking on Carlston Harris. Harris is a UFC debutant here making his debut on Saturday, and we've got a total set at 1.5 rounds. This is a spot that I'm actually very, very interested in, the over 1.5. You can get the alternate line, the 2.5, where it's kind of more of a pick'em price. Over 1.5 is -165, under 1.5 is +145, and it's a little bit chalky, but I definitely lean to the over in this spot. Christian Aguilera is a BJJ brown belt. He's got heavy hands. He's a decent striker, but he's not quite where we want him to be in the UFC. And he's taking on Carlston Harris, a high-level grappler, a guy that just grinds. He pins you up against the fence. He does not let you off the cage. Short of Aguilera landing some kind of a flash knockout, a big bomb in the first round of this fight, I expect Harris to drag Aguilera late into this fight. If this thing gets deep, maybe Aguilera gives up some kind of a submission. We've seen him give that up in the past before, but I don't know if Harris is going to be offensively really looking for that right away. He might just be trying to get his first UFC win, in which case I'm thinking it goes to the judges' scorecard. So over 1.5, -165, very tempted to make that an official bet myself. Over 2.5 at +110, that seems a little bit tasty as well for this thing to make it all the way to the cards at +150 for fight goes to decision. I'd be looking all overs on the first fight of the night. Next up, we've got Jun Young Park taking on Tefon Njikui. We've got Park, who is the Iron Turtle, and that right there should tell you everything you need to know. This man is impossible to finish. He does not get knocked out. He's tough, he's durable, he's gritty. He likes to get in on his opponents, use his striking to close that distance, pin them up against the fence, try and slow the pace of the fight down. Tefon Njikui, 5-0, undefeated as a pro, has a whole lot of room to grow and learn in this space. Big, nasty, powerful type of dude, heavy, heavy hands. There's always the chance that Tefon Njikui can shut off the lights and end your night. Total here set at 2.5. Over is -130. Under is +110. In this kind of a spot, I would be looking to that over. I would bank on Park being able to survive the onslaught of Tefon Njikui. Now, we see Park in his training. He's got a little spot on his chest that really looks like it might be a staph infection. Anybody that's had staph before, we've seen fighters with staph before, it really drains you. It makes you exhausted. It wears you out. Sometimes they don't have the cardio that they usually do because of that. So big red flag for me simply because of that potential staph infection. I don't know if Park is going to have his usual gas tank. I don't know if he's going to have his usual durability if he was fighting staph throughout this fight week and fight preparation. So I got to lean over, but I can't pull the trigger on it because of that. Tefon Njikui is a kid that's going to be growing, improving, getting better every time we see him, and he's already got those heavy, heavy hands. If he clips Park just the right way, if Park slows down in round two and gets tired, you may be looking at a knockout for Tefon. If that's not the case, if these guys both are 100%, if everything goes the way that it should, we might be looking at a split decision, a greasy 15-minute affair where Jung Young Park uses his wrestling and cage control and pushes Tefon up against the fence, and then Tefon maybe gets off on him a little bit when they're in the open space, and it's kind of a battle of who actually won the fight, the guy that controlled or the guy that landed the punches. So I'd be looking over in this spot, but that potential infection has me a little bit hesitant on the Park side of things. Next up, we got a flyweight fight. Ryan Benoit taking on Zaruk Adashev. Total here set at 2.5 rounds, as would be normal for the flyweights. Over is -190. Under is +165. This is one of those weird spots where you've got flyweights that are fully capable of finishing, right? Ryan Benoit's got a ton of power. He's got some big pop in his hands. He's one of the few people, maybe the only guy, that's knocked out Sergio Pettis. I got to go back and look at his record. I think that's the only knockout loss that Sergio's taken. But Benoit's got some serious pop in his hands. Zaruk Adashev is a guy guy that's been knocked out already in the UFC once. We've seen that before, and he's got a long striking career before he made it over to the UFC, and he's only 3-3 in the octagon. You got to think he's got his back up against the wall. You got to think that he's hungry, and he's coming for the win in this spot. Because of that, he's going to have to use his blitz attacks. He's going to have to be explosive and close the pocket, get in tight, use those hands, and that's going to provide the counter opportunity for Ryan Benoit. I almost feel like the move is the under here, getting plus 165 on the under 2.5. Now, flyweights, they're little, so that pop doesn't always translate. Both these guys are tough. Ryan Benoit's been extremely durable inside the UFC's octagon, so I don't know that I want to bank on him getting knocked out. I do think both guys are capable of getting a knockout. This would be kind of like a dog or pass situation for me. It's an under or pass situation for me. I don't think I'm betting this one, but I'm kind of leaning on somebody going to sleep here in this fight, even though it's the little guys. Next up, we got a featherweight fight. Ľudovít Klein taking on Mike Trizano. One of the most interesting fights on the card, in my opinion. Total here set at 2.5, and it's a pick'em. Over 2.5 is minus 110. Under 2.5 is minus 110. I feel like the totals here are really in line with a fighter. We talk about this about every other week. There's always one of these where if you think it's going over, you're probably betting Trizano. He's not the killer type with his power. He's a volume striker. He likes to outclass his opponents, stick and move, work his way around, mix in some grappling. That's what Trizano will do for you. If you've got Ľudovít Klein, you think he's probably going to be the monster we all believe is hiding under our bed, and he's going to come out and smash. He's going to knock Trizano out like we saw him do already, and then this thing cashes for the under. The only problem for me is that Trizano has been very, very durable. We've seen him be tough. We've seen him be gritty. He's been away for a couple of years, though, and that raises questions. What kind of form is he in? Is he in good shape? Is he ready to go? How's his chin? We don't know, because we haven't seen him, but I do think there's a little bit of recency bias on Klein. I do think since we've seen him active recently, we've seen him impressively knock a couple of people out, they're expecting him to just continue to roll on and do the same. Trizano's a guy that trains with Shane Burgos. He's always used to big power and heavy volume coming at him. He's going to be slick on the feet. I think he might be hard for Klein to find on the feet. I think we're in for maybe a 15-minute battle here. I would be looking at the over 2.5 here at a pick'em price, minus 110. I don't see Trizano landing big enough to knock out Klein. And even though Klein can knock Trizano out, I think it's another spot where we could rely on the durability of Mike Trizano and expect him to stay alive in this fight and get it to the judges' scorecards. Whether he wins or loses, then we don't care. The over 2.5 is an interesting spot at minus 110 to me in this case. Middleweight fight, Phil Hawes taking on Kyle Daukaus, maybe one of the big spots on the card that I really circled, and I haven't locked it in yet because the totals just dropped today. It may be maybe an official bet sooner than later here, but we've got the total set at 2.5, over 2.5, plus 130, under 2.5, minus 150. This seems like a dead nuts under to me because you've got Phil Hawes, Megatron, the man that comes out and pounds people's breaks off in the very first round, and just because we saw him go a full 15 last time, everyone is expecting that to be the same case here. Kyle Daukaus, solid boxer, BJJ black belt, good wrestler, good grappler. He's going to look to tire out Hawes, drag him to the mat, drag him to the late rounds, get a submission on him in the second or the third. So if Hawes wins, it's probably going to be early. If Daukaus wins, it's probably going to be late. And I do think with the total here set at 2.5, there's an opportunity to cash that under, even though it's juiced at minus 150. That's a spot I'm very seriously looking at. It looks like some money's coming in that way. So we may want to jump on it sooner than later if you're looking to bet that under, because we're not the only ones feeling that direction. We've got the final fight of the preliminary card. Big Ben Rothwell taking on Philipe Lins. I don't know if it's Philippe or Felipe. I can't ever remember. Total here set at 2.5. Over 2.5, minus 175. Under 2.5, plus 155. I mean, I like over 1.5s for the heavyweights because they seem to be able to get past those. But 2.5s, that's where things start getting sloppy. With Big Ben Rothwell, he's got the power to finish a guy like Lins, but does he pull the trigger and, you know, really go for it? We don't know. There's two versions of my dad, Big Ben Rothwell, that show up, and sometimes you get the one that's just not interested in going for those power shots. Philip Lins, kind of looking for a big shot himself. He's kind of a bit of a sniper, waits to counter, looks for that big bomb, and I don't know that he's going to find it on Big Ben Rothwell, but Rothwell is at the end of his career. We saw him get hurt by OSP. It's not been that long since we've seen him rocked a couple of times. Both these guys are capable of being finished. Both these guys are capable of finishing, but I also feel like we might see a very respecting the other's power type of fight where they keep the distance. Maybe there's some really sluggish cage control with the heavyweight boys just kind of laying on each other. I could see this one squeezing to the judges' scorecards and getting over that 2.5, but I don't want to pay minus 175 for it. So I'm going to say over, but this one's a complete pass for me from a betting perspective. We head on over to the main card where Amanda Ribas takes on Angela Overkill Hill. Total here set at 2.5. The over is minus 220. The under is plus 180. And this is a spot where I feel like we're getting value on the under with two women who are underappreciated in what they're capable of. And it's a spot that I am looking very closely at pulling the trigger on a bet. Amanda Ribas coming off of a bad knockout loss to Marina Rodriguez. She's going to be hungry. She's going to be looking to get back on track. I think that means she's going to grapple. She's going to be looking to get this fight in her wheelhouse, get it to the floor. Don't play with another dangerous striker on the feet. You got to think that's in her head, right? She needs to get right. She needs to get back on track. She needs to get the win. Angela Hill, on the other hand, very technical Muay Thai striker. She's been fighting the best in her division for years. For like the last 10 years, she's been doing nothing but fight the best that the UFC has to offer. And her Muay Thai seems to just be getting better and better and better. Even at this late stage of her career, she is still improving. She sits on her punches a whole hell of a lot more lately. She's been very close to finishing a couple of people in her last couple fights. She's rocked her last two or three opponents with those strikes. And we've seen Ribas have some trouble on the feet when her opponents are able to sit down on those punches. They find those openings. Her stand-up game has got a lot of work. We're in the small cage. That's going to help the grappling if she feels like taking it to the floor. And we've seen Hill submitted. I think both women are perfectly capable of contributing to this under, both with their durability questions and with their finishing capabilities, and getting plus 180 on the under 2.5. I don't think that's a bad look at all, because Angela Hill is going to come out and look to make a push for that title. She's got to beat a name like Ribas. She's got to end the hype train and take all that hype herself to be able to get there. Ribas needs to get right. She's got to come out. She's got to make a statement beating someone like a fan favorite, the female cowboy Cerrone in Angela Hill. She's got to get someone like that on her record to right the ship and get back where she needs to be. With their styles being completely opposing to one another, striker versus grappler, I really think we have the opportunity here for a finish. So that's a spot. I like the under. Very tempted to actually pull the trigger and bet on it myself. The only problem is I've laid the hammer down a couple times already this weekend, so I'm being careful with the other spots that I try and pick and snipe. Next up, we've got Gregor the Gift Gillespie taking on Carlos Diego Ferreira in a wonderful fight that's going to be extremely intriguing. Total here set at 2.5. Over 2.5, minus 175. Under 2.5 is plus 155. And again, this seems like a spot where the line matches the fighter. And in fact, the lines almost perfectly mirror the fighter. Over 2.5 is minus 175. Gregor is minus 175. Under 2.5, plus 155. Diego, plus 155. And that seems the way that it is, right? Gregor Gillespie, maybe the best wrestler we have in the UFC, especially in this division at this point in time. And he's going to come out and look to use that grappling, looks to mix in the takedowns, get CDF playing off of his back, stay safe from top position, and grind this guy for 15 minutes. It's what he does. Now, he does break people, and he does tend to finish people late in fights if he can get there. So the under 2.5 has potential for Gregor to still end up getting that, but we don't see Diego finished very often. So I wouldn't necessarily count on that. Carlos Diego, on the flip side of this thing, improved striking, decent power on the feet, good grappling, high-level BJJ black belt, nasty submission game. If he catches Gillespie in something on the feet, makes him panic wrestle, sinks up a guillotine, something like that, this thing hits to the floor, he's always got the opportunity to look for the back, catch an armbar. I mean, if anyone's finishing this fight, it's probably going to be Diego. So if you pick your fighter, you pick your total. I'm already on Gregor Gillespie. I'm pretty big on Gregor Gillespie in this spot, actually. So I'm leaning towards that over 2.5. Like I said, there's always the chance that he breaks Carlos and gets the finish in the late second or third round when Diego just can't keep up with him. But I don't necessarily see that happening. I kind of think it goes all 15. And that's the way I'm looking at this one. So because I've already got the bet on Gillespie, I'm not touching the total. I would personally look over if I was going to play a bet on that one. We got another heavyweight fight. Maurice Greene, the crochet boss, taking on Marcos Rogério de Lima. Total here set at 1.5 rounds. Over 1.5 is plus 115. The under 1.5 is minus 130. And how can you ever possibly think about betting the over in a Marcos Rogério de Lima fight? This guy has 4 minutes of gas. 4 minutes of gas. He doesn't even have a full one round of gas. He comes out hard. He's got big, heavy hands, big, thick tree trunk legs. He fires those leg kicks, tries to chop his opponent down, and then he swings heavies trying to get you out of there. And if he can't get you out of there in the first round, he tends to slow down and gas out, and then he's kind of a sitting duck for the rest of the fight. Maurice Greene, dude's got a brick head. I know he got KO'd in his last fight, but That was more of a mercy stoppage than it was really a KO. His eyes didn't roll back. He didn't lose consciousness. He was getting beat, but he was saved by the official. It wasn't because he lost his consciousness. I don't know if this guy can get knocked out by these mid to low tier heavyweights. He's just too freaking durable. His head is too hard to actually get out of there. I'm worried about the leg kicks of Lima. That's actually more the path that I would see for a TKO victory for Marcos Rogério de Lima over Greene, because he doesn't really... I don't know if he has the swarm ability that he's going to need like Greg Hardy had to be able to control Maurice Greene on the ground and get the TKO victory, unless he really hurts him bad on the feet. And again, I think it's first round or bust. Now, if he doesn't get the finish in the first round, this thing heads into round two. How long can he last with Maurice Greene? Maurice Greene is long. He's tall. He's got decent striking, and he knows how to use that reach. And then he's got slick grappling. And he actually already did an interview where he came out and he said that he guarantees he is submitting Marcos Rogério de Lima. I believe him. Personally, I believe him, and I'm very, very interested in Maurice Greene as an underdog, and I'm very interested in that Maurice Greene sub prop. I'll tell you that right now. The interesting spot, though, is the total here at 1.5. Do we think Maurice Greene has to drag Lima into the late deep waters in the second or the third round to get that submission, or is it going to be a scramble fest in the first round and stay under? I think the under 1.5 at minus 135, I think that makes some sense, just because if Marcos de Lima is going to win, he's going to do it early. He's going to do it in the first round. You've got 2 minutes and 30 seconds worth of the second round that if it gets there, Maurice Greene can work and try and get that done for you. But I don't personally like this 1.5 because it's right on that line of where you think the fight is maybe going to flip on its edge. I think Maurice Greene probably stays safe in the first round. He tries to get some cage control, tries to slow the pace down. Maybe Marcos de Lima has a little bit of success in the first round, but I think this thing gets to round two. I really do. And once it gets to round two, then I think it really starts to light up, and then I think Greene kind of starts to take over, and he gets a second or a third round submission. That's kind of how I see the fight playing out. So I would look at maybe the value on the over 1.5 at plus 115, or maybe just the fight starts round two at a pick'em price. You can get minus 110, minus 115 on the fight starts round two, and I think that might be a little bit of a better spot to have it, but... You know, if you think Lima is more than live for the knockout here, just take that under 1.5 because you can't trust the guy as far as you can throw him past the first round. Co-main event, we've got Neal Magny taking on Geoff Neal, and another extremely interesting fight from a matchmaking perspective. Total here set at 2.5. Over 2.5 is minus 150. Under 2.5 is plus 130. And it's kind of a pick-your-fighter situation again. Neal Magny is a decision machine. He's got excellent cardio, looks to make a fight boring, drag his opponent up against the fence, and just slow things down. Neal Magny is a fantastic striker with heavy hands. He's explosive. He's got head kicks. He's always looking for that finish. We've seen Neal Magny take some serious punishment and not get finished until the championship rounds. So even if Neal comes out and has some success on the feet, it doesn't necessarily mean that he'll be able to get Magny out of there. And if Magny has his way, he will be pinning Neal up against the fence, slowing the fight down, making it very, very boring. The only problem for me is that Neal is a powerhouse, very physically strong, this guy. So I don't know if Neal Magny is going to be able to actually pin him up against the cage and hold him there for 10, 15 minutes the way he normally would like to. I think he might end up getting overpowered, reversed, and then have Neal split out to the center of the cage once again. But I'm kind of feeling like, oh, geez, maybe this thing slides over. It's 2.5. Maybe it makes its way to the judges' scorecards and Neal does enough scoring to negate the grappling control of Neal Magny. Neal Magny kind of hangs in there, doesn't quite get clipped and knocked out all the way, gets hurt a couple times, but manages to grind his way through. The under at plus 130 is tempting, but at the under, you're basically saying that Neal wins, and if Neal's going to win by knockout, you might as well play that prop, Neal by knockout, because it's plus 160, plus 175, somewhere in that ballpark. You're getting a better price tag on that. I don't see Neal Magny getting a submission on Geoff Neal, and I definitely don't see Neal Magny knocking out Geoff Neal in any form or fashion. So because of that, the only way I see this fight finishing is Neal by knockout, and if that's your only path, you might as well play that prop specifically, and then everything else take the over 2.5 at minus 150 and just hold your nose. I am not betting that total. I am not betting that total. So don't take all of that with a grain of salt. That's a very, very difficult fight to call, in my opinion. And I apologize. We've got a new co-main event. The actual co-main event is the rebooked fight of Donald Cerrone taking on Alex Morono. Morono's coming in here on short notice, replacing Diego Nightmare Sanchez. Donald Cerrone is a guy that's notoriously been a bit of a slow starter, and he's always talked about that. Everyone talks about him getting up and getting early. Well, he was training in this fight camp to take on Diego Sanchez, a guy with there's bad blood. He had bad intentions. He wanted to hurt Diego because of their history together. He was looking to finish Diego, send him out on his, you know, Viking ship, and then do his flaming arrow and send it into him, burn him to death on the way out. Donald Cerrone wanted that finish. He wanted that pain. He wanted that violence. And now he's got a guy in Alex Morono who's extremely aggressive, a guy that's going to come forward, a guy that's going to look to land bombs on him, and a guy that's taking the fight short notice. What kind of cardio is Alex Morono going to have for this fight? We don't really know. He's got a couple of training partners that are on this card, so he's been in camp, he's been working with them, he's been helping them out, but it's not the same as having a camp yourself. And because of that, we got to think maybe he's not 100% for this one, and if that's the case, he might be coming out and looking for an early get or done type of situation. In an interview recently, Donald Cerrone said that he understands that that might be the case. He knows what's happened here with the flip of his opponent change. He knows he's now got a young, hungry opponent, not an old veteran dog that he might be able to coast with. He knows he's got a guy that he's not going to have the luxury of starting slow with. He said he's going to get the first two rounds of the fight out backstage before he walks out. So whether that's hard sparring or going harder than he usually does on the mitts to make sure he's awake and he's ready to start that fight when he gets out there and that cage door shuts, I believe him. I know a lot of people give me crap for believing fighters in their interviews, but you could see the fire in his eyes when he talked about that. He knows what's at stake here. He's on a 5-fight losing streak. He absolutely needs this win. And on top of that, he's been doing a lot of grappling lately. Cowboy Cerrone is a very underrated wrestler, but he's a nasty submission finisher. In fact, he tapped out Rafael Dos Anjos in his last grappling match. If he can do that, he can tap Alex Morono. I can absolutely see Donald Cerrone starting this fight very quickly, more so than he usually does. Morono meeting him in the center. These guys throw down and someone gets rocked and then club and subbed. Or Cerrone making a very well-timed level change, getting Morono to the ground, having a scramble type of situation, and one of them finishing by submission. Not sure which one it's going to be because they're both high-level black belts. They both know how to grapple. They're both explosive. Both guys can knock out. Like, this is going to be a great fight. I think it's going to be violence, and I really like this under 2.5. Plus 160, plus 165 on the under 2.5 for the co-main event. Music to my ears based on the way these two guys are talking. They're both talking about starting fast, getting the finish, looking to add that name on the resume, getting right in their careers. Donald Cerrone trying to save his job. I mean, there's a lot on the line for this fight, and you got to think both of them are looking to make a statement. So getting a plus line on two dangerous finishers that are both more than capable of being finished, I like that spot. Main event, we've got Michelle Waterson, the karate hottie, taking on Marina Rodriguez. Total here set at 4.5. 4.5 total, because this is a 5-round main event, folks. The first thing that you need to know is that this 5-round main event was put together on short notice. These women both are taking this fight on like 2 weeks-ish notice because we had the main event fallout just recently. So we got to wonder what kind of shape they're in. We got to wonder what kind of cardio they've got coming for this one. Michelle Waterson, she's a solid technical striker on the feet, although she swings from like 2 miles away and misses 90% of the time. Kind of like Caitlin Chookagian. You remember the kiosk that she scores on the judges' scorecards with, even though she didn't really hit anybody. Michelle Waterson does a very, very similar type of thing. But she'll be able to handle her own in the striking. She's got that sidekick, the karate styling. That's going to be a benefit to her, but she's fighting a much longer, lankier Marina Rodriguez that I think even when Michelle Waterson's in kicking distance, I think Marina will still be able to tag her on the feet. She's got those long gorilla arms going on. And Rodriguez has got serious power. You can't think Michelle Waterson really wants to strike with this girl on the feet. You think Michelle is going to look for the takedown. We've seen Rodriguez have a real hard time defending the takedown, defending the grappling. She does get back up to her feet, though, and when she does, she gets her opponents tired, and she hits them, and she hurts them. She's hurt everybody she's been in the cage with, and it's just a matter of can they get that takedown again. So if Michelle Waterson is able to get the takedown and just grind on Rodriguez, she's got a nasty submission game. Michelle Waterson is more than capable of finding the back and choking somebody out. And then if she stays on the feet, if Marina Rodriguez is able to stuff one or two of those takedowns, if she's able to get back to her feet after one or two of those takedowns, Michelle Waterson, I think, is in trouble on the feet facing the type of striker that she is and the kind of power that Marina Rodriguez brings to the table. This is a spot where, once again, I want to bet on violence. It is extremely dangerous, extremely touchy, betting on women's MMA unders because they're just really hard to come by. But I think this is a perfect mix for it. Short notice fight, questionable gas tanks, up a weight class that's going to lend more power to Rodriguez than she normally would have after having a weight cut. and then the size discrepancy, the difference in the styles, grappling versus striking. Once again, one person is going to find their way out of their normal wheelhouse. I can't say Michelle Waterson will be out of her wheelhouse striking, but against this caliber of a striker, I do kind of think that she's going to be a little bit on the back foot here. So the under 4.5, I think, holds a lot of value, especially at plus 170, plus 185. There's a rogue plus 200 hanging out there that you might be able to get. That's the spot that I would be looking on this fight, and another one that I may very well actually lock in as a bet myself. That's the takedown, folks. Total takedown Thursday. Make sure you smash that like button, share this video out there, hit a retweet for me if you don't mind, subscribe here to the main channel at Pub Sports Radio. Good luck on all your degenerate action. I will see you tomorrow for weigh-ins, unless you're watching this in the future. In that case, let's roll.